بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة العالمين نبينا وحبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أما بعد. So today, inshallah, will be the first lesson after that long break that was not intended. Honestly speaking, I never think of coming back. And the brothers has been talking. But alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changed the mind. So I will highlight some issues here. And then inshallah upon them we will move, inshallah. Last time we began with this class, and to me it was a success. At first when we asked for registration, I think Brother Fadil got, and in fact actually I was looking for those students who were coming to our class for almost 5 or 6 years here, some sisters. So I told Fadil, get for us at least 2, 3, 4, 5 to sit and study deeply the knowledge of fiqh and usul fiqh. I mean, in the very conservative way, in the way we will try to, make a scholar, bismillah ta'ala. So Fadil used his own way, then he told me that 200 and something registered. So how did you get that? He said, Facebook. So I didn't use it, I don't know how it works, but he gave me the list of almost 300 students. So I just swallowed. I said, no problem, let's begin. So I know in my mind that this is how it always begin, but alhamdulillah, the first class, it was more than 100 people, I think, or 80 at least. But then the class started to go down slowly. So I have an experience in terms of learning process. I know this is how it always begins in every place. From the brothers or from the sisters, you see at first the attendance is too much. But then afterwards, only the serious people will remain. So we end up sometimes having 2, 3, 4, 5 students in the class from 300 people. That was not a problem. And, the Salaf al-Saleh, some of them used to have less than that. They mentioned that one of them, if he comes out of his house and he sees more than 15 students, he will go back. Because to him, there is no seriousness in that. Only few are the ones who are serious and he doesn't want to waste his time. So as I said, that was not that much a problem. But the main concern here, what have we attained? I mean, gain during those lessons. This is the main concern here. Alhamdulillah, we got around 10 students who are coming to the class from time to time. Some of them will be absent, some. But the point is, they continued until the end of the day. We stopped the class for the sake of examination. So now we have come back, alhamdulillah, for wisdom. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. And I was dependent on the culture. That people here usually they're very shy, they will not tell you come back, they will wait, you initiate first, and then they will come, all of them. So I told the brothers, I will use this opportunity to do my work. But then Allah SWT sent, two sisters through email, and one of them came and talked to me directly, and the class, alhamdulillah, is back. So I wish. This is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wants good for us. So in this regard, I will remind you about the following, and then bismillah ta'ala, I wish we will begin upon that. So please remember, I mentioned earlier in the first lesson that we had, that you are needed in the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And wallahi, see, I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is one of the greatest time that the Ummah is in a need of a serious student who can dedicate their life to learn the deen properly and convey it to others. So at this moment, nothing works except you jeopardizing your masalih and your interests and focus on what benefits the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Learn the deen and be patient. And sometimes the lesson might not be interesting. This is a complaint across the history. The students sometimes they come to get an interesting lesson. And that's wrong. The intention should be, I'm here to get something new, regardless of the way it is conveyed to me. Nowadays, we depend on the fancy things and things that will not, add to our reward or decrease it. I mean, the benefit is either little or there is nothing actually in terms of benefit in them. So fancy way of talking, this is what we believe in. So I think you guys, you don't need this at all. So it is my personal advice to you, in order for the class to be continuous and also to make sure that we learn as much as we could in this class and then we achieve the goal in which the class it is established, I really need your patience, that's one. And secondly, I also really need your commitment. Whereby you take the lesson and you go back home and you revise. Whatsoever you hear, you take it. Abdullah ibn Abbas was with his student Sa'id ibn Jubayr. Sa'id ibn Jubayr used to write every single thing he learned from Abdullah ibn Abbas. They mentioned that what he usually do, he will bring the pens and the books and the papers he has, he will finish all of the books, and then what else? He will write on his hand, on the hand also. If the book finish, the papers finish, he will write. Because he writes everything that comes out of the mouth of Abdullah ibn Abbas. So he will write everything on the hand, write on the other hand also, he writes on his shoes, he writes on anything that can be can accept writing. So the friends, they blamed him badly. They say, what's wrong with you? What kind of writing is this? What are you taking from? You take everything, he said. So they used to make fun of him. But then look at him at the end of the day. The scholars mentioned that he is the Sayyid al-Tabi'in. He is the Sayyid al-Tabi'in in terms of knowledge. They said, if you go to Sayyid ibn al-Musayyib, he has some specialization. If you go to Atta, he has some specialization. If you go to Mujahid, he has some specialization. But if you talk about Sa'id ibn Jubayr, then you will not understand what field he specialized, because he is expert in almost everything. If you talk, you will think that he is better than all of those people who specialize in fiqh or talaq or any other discipline. How did he get that? Because he always focuses and he's very committed and he writes almost everything. At the end of the day, he becomes one of the leaders of the righteous people in terms of knowledge. So that's knowledge. And this is how they get it. And we also, for us to get the proper one, wallahi, I'm telling you, my sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you really want the barakah, you have to be patient and you have to really be committed. Let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala see from your heart that you have nothing except the intention of learning how to gain as much as I could. I'm not belittling any university, even the Islamic University of Medina. If you're going to depend on what you get in the university alone, it will be very difficult for you to become a scholar. We never sat down. We used to go out and look for the scholars, and this is the advice also we got from our righteous scholars who loves us for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I remember, as I said, I'm not belittling in any university on the face of the earth, but in the university, usually you get the basics and the keys. The real knowledge that can make you a reliable scholar is the one that you go and chase the scholars and get it from them. Lessons like this, lessons in the houses of the scholars, if you can get to the house and get it from there. This is how the righteous predecessors got it. So I remember one of our professors, I told him I want to apply for masters in Islamic University of Medina. He told me, Ibrahim, if you are applying for the masters, for the sake of getting the certificate, I really advise you to leave this country and go back to your country and teach people the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it will be useless. But if you know that during the process of compiling your master's program, you're going to go against, around the scholars and chase them and get the knowledge from them, I really advise you to fight for it. Don't leave the country before you get the master's program, because at least you have 4 years to go and chase the scholars and get from them. So we do that. And this is what helped us also to acquire the knowledge. Many of those efforts, we got them from the scholars out of the university. So I really advise you, purify your intention. I know it is pure. Inshallah, our intention, be in light, Allah is pure, but make it more pure. Hear the classes in the way it is, and it will remain like that. Inshallah. So nobody brought you here, and you don't pay for it, and nobody's paying for it. Neither me, neither you, nobody is paying for it. So me and you and the remainder of the brothers, we just volunteer to come and serve the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala see a good intention from us. Bismillah ta'ala, barakah will be placed. With the little we get, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it to serve as a principle to know how to deal with the current issues and the issues of the community. Whatever they arise, you will be a very strong, reliable person for the community. That was the intention, inshallah. So please, number one is patience, after sincerity. Number two is commitment. Commitment to the class. What does that mean? Don't you ever skip the class if it is not necessary. I will really, really emphasize on this. And please, wallahi, you see, I swear by Allah, this is my personal belief. No course arranged by an organization or institution, those courses that they have 1 or 2 days, will give you the benefit you get in the classes like this. But those ones, they are so fancy, and the way they arrange them, I'm not criticizing them, but I'm just telling you what benefits you more, what makes you as a scholar. Take this from me if you wish. If you are to waste your time, or let me be more positive, if you were to use the valuable time you are having to attend those courses and jeopardize classes that is organized by anyone, I'm not talking about our class, but any class that is having the same nature, most likely you are going to remain throughout your life. You will never be like that scholar who is teaching you in the course. You will never reach them. The way you learned is to go to the YouTube and take from this and that, anything you just combine here and there. You will remain like that. You will never be like the one who is speaking. But if you attend lessons like this, you have a book, you go and revise. In few days, bismillah ta'ala, few years, few months, bismillah ta'ala, you will be qualified either better than the one who is speaking to you or who is teaching you, or at least at his level. But you will never remain in the way you are. That's what I see. I'm talking based on experience. If your life is like that, because now I realize that one of the problems also we encountered last time was a lot of excuses. Alhamdulillah, the excuse is not just I'm going to market or I'm going to visit so and so and so. The excuse is I'm going to attend a course. I'm going to attend this and that. And sometimes it costs a lot. So I do believe, if you are paying attention, what you get from here, these are the principles and the legal maxims, something to establish you, bismillah ta'ala, to make you a reliable person in the future. So please, be very committed to the class. Come to the class, unless if it is necessary. If I have problem, I will apologize to you that I can come. You also, if you have a problem, you should apologize and stay home and deal with the problem. But this problem should be a necessity. If you see me saying that to you that this class, I cancel it, I will not come, believe it or not, it is something that, I mean, prevent me from coming to the class. Usually I don't stop class when I begin it. Okay, thank you. When I begin a class, I don't stop it. It goes like that. Some of my classes for 10 years after this moment, we were doing. And I go to them 80 kilometers coming back every weekend. It doesn't stop after this moment. Even today, being in light, we're going for that class for almost 10 years here in Malaysia. So this class is one of the most interesting class to me, and I love the class so much. So that's why I will come. So I want to see, please, seriousness. I'm not concerned of the amount. That's why I told one of the students who were interested in coming back to the class, may Allah reward her with Firdaus. I told her, if I can get 5 to 6 people, is more than enough just to begin the class. That huge amount, I'm not thinking of anything actually. I wasn't looking for it, it just came. So I know it is going to perish and come back to the smaller amount. So this one also, I was looking for that. But Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring around 10 or 20, I see from the emails I sent. So that's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I never thought that we have some people who are thinking of coming back. But Alhamdulillah, we are back. So I will repeat, please, patience and commitment to the class, and try get the book. Don't come and sit and write almost everything. Even if you don't have the textbook, but just bring the pen and bring your exercise book and write. And if you have a question, don't stop asking. They ask Abdullah ibn Abbas, they attributed this statement to him. How did he get this intensive amount of knowledge? He said, bilisanin sa'ul wa qalbin aqul. He said, I get this knowledge because of this lisanun sa'ul. Lisanun sa'ul is the tongue that always asks questions. Always ask, doesn't keep quiet. And also wa qalbin aqul, and the heart that is always attentive to the knowledge. You get idea. This is the most important thing that a student of knowledge needs. That's why in Sahih Bukhari, in the first part of Sahih Bukhari, Imam Bukhari has a chapter that says, لا يتعلم متكبر ولا مستحيين. He says, an arrogant person will never learn. That's the title of the chapter. He said, an arrogant person will never learn, and also at the same time, مستحيين, a shy person also will never learn. This is how it works. So in terms of knowledge, you have to remove the shyness. It doesn't mean you misbehave. No, the shyness here that we're talking about, the shyness that deprive you from asking questions that concerns you in terms of learning. Do you get it? So please do ask. When we open a question and answer session, please do ask. Don't keep quiet. Unless if everything is clear and you don't have a question, then that's it. But I think you should have a question. Seriously. You should have a question, because students of knowledge, they always have a question, because people are looking at you and there are things going in the society. You bring them to the class, also we discuss them in the class, we find a solution so that tomorrow if somebody asks you, you know how to reply. Figure out, I mean, questions, when I say question, it doesn't necessarily be the questions that concerns the class we take. No, I'm talking about questions, any kind of question that comes to your mind that can benefit somebody else in the class or somebody else that can hear the lesson. So be committed, come to the class, write everything that can be written, and also ask questions. If there is something that you think you should write it to remember it, but unfortunately you couldn't take it, so please ask me to repeat it. I will repeat bismillah ta'ala. I hope this is clear, inshallah. Okay, so the class will begin, insha'Allah ta'ala, 2. Now, Dhuhr is very early, right? So I will have my chance to come to the university, on time, bismillah ta'ala. 2, I will be here, either 2 or before 2. And also, I agreed with myself to, in the usul, they have this ijma, one person making ijma. So I agree with myself to have 1 hour class. This is I will speak, and then another 30 minutes for question and answers. Our classes will never exceed 1.5 hours. No more 2 hours, no more 3 hours, no more until Asr. So we'll come to maximum, we stay here, inshallah, we will never exceed 3:30. Yeah, sometimes if there is no question, once I finish, I see the clock here, 1 hour class, I will just stop at any moment. And then wait for the questions and answers. Bismillah ta'ala, let's begin with this, inshallah. And I decide to make it only Saturday class. And unless if there is a need to have Sunday class, I'm also ready for that. I will be having a GSM class on Sunday, that's tomorrow. So I finish my class and then I can just come up and have an Arabic class here. But I will ask you also to see your interest, then I will come, bismillah ta'ala. Based on your interest and your advice, how shall we deal with the issue, and then I will come. But this one, bismillah ta'ala, it will be continuous. The fifth class, Saturday, 2 to 3:30, bismillah ta'ala. So if possible, do come early on time, if it is possible. I know maybe some people might be living outside, might be difficult, but if it is possible, do come at exactly 2, so that we can utilize that 1 hour without being in a state of need of having any kind of extension, bismillah ta'ala. So that's a class, and every Saturday it will be like that, bismillah ta'ala. So that's all from my side, and I would like to hear from you about the class. Any advice that you have, or Any thing that you would like to suggest, which you think if we can apply it, bismillah ta'ala, it will benefit all. So with that, I give you a chance to talk, and then if time permits, I will go through the book, bismillah ta'ala. Okay, the time is yours now, inshallah. What was the last lesson we had in fiqh? We start al-hayd wal-nifas. We didn't finish that. That was the time, that was the place you have, right? Okay. No problem. Okay, any question? Any question about anything? The videos that we did last year, last semester, are they all uploaded? No. Okay. Inshallah, we'll take them from Muhammad Tanzani, and we're going to burden somebody from Kashmir, inshallah, to do the job. Inshallah. Or I will do it myself if I know how to do it, inshallah. Okay. Any question? Any question? Any question? Okay. Do you think you benefited from the last lessons? What is the percentage? I used to have somebody here. One day made me scared in the class. How many percent of the lessons you understand? It was, I think, how many percent? I forgot. But 80%, that's for sure, was missing. Only 20% most likely was understood. But alhamdulillah, we reached a time also we asked. She said now 80% is understood and 20% is missing. So I will ask now the class also, the last lesson, was it beneficial, a beneficial lesson? Honest, do you think you gained something? Sio, do you think you're moving forward? Or the class is just transit, yes. Come on here, do you think you're moving forward in those days? Sure, okay. Do you think the method used to teach you the fiqh, since we're doing the fiqh, it's okay, you understand what is said in the class? Serious? Okay. May Allah put barakah in it, inshallah. So we will continue with the same thing, be the light, ta'ala, inshallah. How about the Arabic language? Who benefited from the Arabic class at least 1%? Not even 100. Who benefited? Okay, alhamdulillah. If the Arabic class is to come back, will you be happy flying out of happiness, or you will say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajiun? We are trying to avoid talking about this issue, but at last he brought it back. So if you want the class to come back, so we can begin, inshallah, starting from next week, not tomorrow. But reply with the same email, just say yes for Arabic class, like that. I just want to say the number, if I have 5 people, yes for the Arabic class, inshallah ta'ala, we will come back for the Arabic class. Either we go for that book, some people are suggesting a very, very basic in Arabic language, we begin with that. So if all of you agreed, I really hate beginning, a book and then I cut it, I stop it in the middle. But if that is necessary, we will do in the way we did with the first book, and we come back to the second book. And I think second book, if we go in the way we are doing, inshallah, we can afford. But if you think that is something very difficult, then I will try to see some other, option. But then until when are we going to stop then? Keep on going like this. The moment we feel some difficulty, then we stop. And by the way, honestly speaking, Nahu is always like that. Nahu is always like that. I remember one of our scholars, Shaikh Sheikh Ibn Thamin, he said, rahimahullah, when he first taught them the Nahw, the same book we are learning, he said people believe that Nahw is difficult. That's why they always run away from it. The classes of Arabic language, if it is going to be studied properly, that's why only few people continue. So he said people believe that the thing is difficult, that's why they run away. He said everything in this life is like that. But only patience will make it easy. That's why the Arabic poet says, I'm going to use patience until the difficult becomes easy. وَمَنْ قَادَتِ الْآمَالُ إِلَّا لِصَابِرِ. And he said, wishes and objective will never submit to a person except somebody who is patient. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يُفَصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ غَيْرِ حِسَابٍ وَمَا يُلَقَّهَا إِلَّا صَابِرُونَ. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about patience in many places because the key to succeed in this life is patience. وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we made them leaders on the face of the earth. They're guided by our command. When they were patient, they became the leaders on the face of the earth. So patience is needed in everything. And that's why I kept on telling you, if you're patient and show interest in the learning process, the most important thing after ikhlas is the interest. If you're interested, you will get it. If you're not interested, I'm telling you, you will never get it. The key to succeed in learning is to have the interest. Last time I told you about one of our professors, he said, nobody succeeded in the class in the University of Medina in terms of teaching English language except one person. They asked him, how did he manage to succeed? He said, because what he did first was to let the student believe in the subject first and have strong interest in it. Then he began the lesson and they succeeded. He was the only person that was able to teach them the language. Nobody succeeded because when they come, they jump into the system without taking the interest of the student. So inshallah, if you agree to come back, I'm also willing to come back to continue with our mission. But just send to me yes for Arabic class. And if you have any suggestion when we come to the class, then you say the suggestion, bi'iznillahi ta'ala. And I would like to continue with that book. And I would like to you to be patient. I mean, we can cut it short. We can have a 30-minute or a 45-minute of a class, maximum. Take the little amount. Repeat it. That's the reason why I like that book, because he repeats one thing a lot. And after every lesson, he will take you back to the old lesson first and then move. So you will never forget the old one, because Nahw is like this. Just like the mathematics, like the knowledge of fara'id, you need to understand the first one and keep it with you until the end. So inshallah, I will be waiting for your reply today, bismillah ta'ala, for whoever is interested. So until now, I'm the one who is talking. Last call for questions. Any questions or comment? Yes. Okay, what do you think? It's okay to have a Saturday class, half an hour, then we have the Arabic class? No, then we cut from the fifth class. Okay. Yeah, that's your choice. But then I choose another option, which is 1 hour for fifth class, half an hour for Arabic class. Do you get what I mean? Instead of 2 hours, then 1.5 hours for the whole class. You take from my time, I take from yours also. But do you want to go for the Arabic right after this? I'm not talking to the one who posed the... I'm asking the remainder of the class. Would you be happy if you're going to have 2 classes, 1.5 hour for fit, and then we have the Arabic class for 30 minutes, for example? Is that okay? It's okay for all, right? Okay. So I think that's good, inshallah. It's okay. You, I don't care about your choice, but I think that's good, inshallah. Instead of coming back again on Sunday, I think that this should be okay. we start with Arabic then fiqh. Wallahi, that's good, because if you start with the fiqh, then the interest was already taken. But the people, they like fiqh. You start with the one they don't like first, and then finish it, so they will be patient. Thinking of fiqh is going to come will bring the interest back again also. Wallahi, that's good. So we start with the Arabic for refreshment, just for 30 minutes, and then we stop it and go for. That's a good idea, inshallah. So from next week, Bizin Light, Allah, you come with this intention, Bizin Light. You have the book of Ajr Rumiya. Please, if you don't have, let me know. Before next week, I'll provide the soft copy and send it to your email. You must get it to understand. I mean, to be honest to ourselves, we must have the book. It will never work without the book. Forget about this is Arabic, I don't understand Arabic. No, this is how we understand it. You get it? This is how we understand. You must have the book, you hold the book, the barakah is there, and you read the Arabic text. It will be, inshallah, clinging in your brain. It will stay there. This is how you get the vocabularies, these light. So starting from next week, inshallah ta'ala, we will continue with what we began. So if you can help me, inshallah, revise what we had studied. It was not that much, right? Revise what we have studied. When we come next week, inshallah, I will ask questions randomly. You get it? So to make sure that what we had studied was there, remembered, and then we move. Or else if I'm going to continue and then you don't remember the one behind, we'll keep on having problem in the future. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you. Any other comment? Thanks for talking at last. Any other comment or suggestion or question? Yes. Exam, okay, let us. Okay, for the time being, no. But what I will do is, because usually the classes when exam exist, it's so scary, and the value of the knowledge also, Wallahu alam, this is my observation, will be very little. Because people will be serious when exam comes in. So I will try to see the seriousness of the class, and I will do the practical exams, the verbal exams, almost every day. How was that? Before we begin a lesson, I will ask about the previous lessons. Almost everything we did, I will ask randomly. And I think how I should make it is, no book should be opened. And that's it. And also to save the exam, before you answer my question, you have to, state your name first. And we will appoint, I think, somebody amongst you to have a piece of paper, write the name. How many times so-and-so-and-so person failed in the questions asked in the class. So then the next time we know whom to advise and who is serious and who is not serious. I think it's better than the exam, right? Okay, so we will go like that based on life. It's more beneficial. This is what our scholars used to do, to revise the topic and the lesson every day. Instead of having one day to come and sit down for the exam, a person might not be serious unless if the exam approaches it. So inshallah, be patient. We will have the example. You might be the first person to be asked, inshallah. Okay, last word. Anything else? Nothing. Okay, Abdul Rahman. We still have 26 minutes for the class, so read, inshallah. The first part of the talk. If you remember the place where precisely we stopped, then go for that. If not, then start from the first one. Do you remember where we stopped? Precisely the place. The beginning. Wait, 1 second. Nobody remembers. Al-Nifas. The place where they said وَيَخْرُجُ مِنَ الْفَجِّ ثَلَاثَةُ دِيمَا, right? Right. Okay, Abraman, go ahead, inshallah. المؤلف
رحمه الله فصل ويخرج من الفرج ثلاثة دماء دم الحيض والنفاس والاستحاضة فالحيض وهو دم الخارج
دم
وهو دم الخارج من الفرج المرأة عن سبيل الصحة من غير سبب الولادة ولونه أسود محترم محترم الدعم والنفاس وهو الدم وهو دم الخارج عقب الولادة والاستحاضة وهو دم الخارج في غير أيام الحيض والنفاس. وأقل الحيض يوم وليلة وأكثر وأكثره 15 يوما.
خمسة عشر يوما.
وغالبه 6 أو 7. وأقل النفاس لحظة. وأكثره 60 يوما وغالبه 40 يوما وأقل الطهر بين الحيضتين 15 يوما ولا حد لأكثر
لأكثره
ولا حد لأكثره وأقل زمن تحيض وأقل زمن تحيض فيه المرأة 9 سنين
أنت عندك جارية أو المرأة؟ أوكي عندي جارية.
وأقل زمن تحيض فيه المرأة 9 سنين وأقل الحمل 6 أشهر وأكثره 4 سنين وغالبه 9 أشهر.
Because all of these things, I think we study the vast majority of them when we talk about the issue in that small book, right? So I will just go in brief to revise and then move to the something that we did not start studying. وَيَحْرُمُ بِالْحَيْضِ 8
والاستمتاع بما بين السربة والركبة ويحرم على الجنب 5 أشياء الصلاة وقراءة القرآن ومس المصحف وحمله والطواف واللقط في المسجد ويحرم على المحدث 3 أشياء الصلاة والطواف ومس
Hey, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wa salatu wa salamu ala al-ma'uth rahmatan lil alameen, nabiyyina wa habibina Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Amma ba'd. Qala al-mu'allif rahimahullahu ta'ala wa yakhruju min al-farji 3 dima. This one we studied, I guess, because I remember me repeating this many times. There are three types of blood that usually comes from the private part. The first one is dam al-hayd, the hayd, wa dam al-nifas, and the nifas, wa dam al-istihada, and the istihada. Al-hayd, you already know what is that. They define it, and here also he said, huwa ad-dam الخارج على سبيل الصحة من غير سبب الولادة. If you go back to that book that we used last time, the book written by Ibn Uthaymeen about الدماء الطبيعية عند النساء, he also gives a proper definition for the حيض. It's a blood that comes out بسبب الطبيعة. I mean naturally. It is not based on illness or sickness or deficiency. It is just part of the nature of humankind. the female, the daughters of Adam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it is the blood that Allah SWT has written upon the sisters of the daughters of Adam alayhi salam. So this definition is needed. فَالْحَيْضُ هُوَ الْخَارِجُ الدَّمُ الْخَارِجُ عَلَى سَبِيلِ السِّحَّةِ. He said it's the blood that comes out. عَلَى سَبِيلِ السِّحَّةِ means not because of illness. عَلَى سَبِيلِ السِّحَّةِ means the one who has it is okay. It's healthy, is okay. It's not illness, it's not deficiency, it's not a problem happen. This is part of the nature. مِنْ غَيْرِ سَبَبِ الْوُلَادَةِ, not because of delivery. I mean, wilada means giving birth of a child. Because there is another blood that comes out because of that. So he says any blood that comes out not because of wilada, you get it? We call it hayd. Hatta yatabayyana bidaleelin qat'iyyin annahu istihada. The first assumption is when we see a blood coming at any age, this is what we studied last time, at any age, at any moment from a woman, this blood is called hayd. And nowhere for somebody to look at it as istihada except if he has a strong evidence for that. How do we know that? Because the scholars mentioned, based on the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we have only one blood that comes from the daughters of Adam alayhi salam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Aisha, he said, "Innama huwa damun katabahu Allahu ala banati Adam." He said, "This is the blood that Allah SWT has written it upon the sisters, the daughters of Adam." So they understood from this statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that no any other blood comes except hayd. So the first thing that will come to the mind when we see the blood at any age, we just assume that this blood is hayd, and therefore we have to apply all of the laws and all of the rulings mentioned by the Sharia to govern the issue of hayd upon that blood at any age it comes. That's the opinion of Shaykh Al-Salam bin Taymiyyah, Imam Al-Bukhari, Imam Ad-Darimi, and many, many other scholars. And that's the closest opinion, because there is nothing from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to say otherwise. Clear. So he said in defining the hayd, he said we have three types of blood that usually appears: the blood of hayd, and the second one is the nifas, and the third one is the hayd. He said the hayd is the one that comes out ala sabil sihhati, adamu al kharij ala sabil sihha min ghair sabab al wilada. That's hayd. And nifas. He said, "Huwa al-kharij aqib al-wilada," is a blood that comes bi sabab al-wilada. It is not part of the tabi'a. It is not part of the nature of humankind. It has a cause. Hayd has no cause. It's nature. It's natural. And nifas has a cause. And the cause is what? Wilada. When the child comes, usually the nifas will come. And sometimes before the child also comes, that blood will start coming. Not necessarily the child, the blood comes aqib al-wilada. Sometimes it begins before the wilada, during the contractions. So this is nifas. That was hayd, and this is nifas. وَالْإِسْتِحَاضَةُ هُوَ الْخَارِجُ مِنْ غَيْرِ أَيَّامِ الْحَيْدِ وَالنِّفَاسِ. Istihada is any continuous blood which comes out not in the days of hayd or a nifas. As-sihada is the blood that is continuous. It doesn't stop. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect, but it doesn't stop. It is either continuously coming out without having a break, or sometimes it comes and it goes, comes and goes, comes and goes, comes and goes, but throughout the year it never stops. That's what? That's the nifas, that's the istihada. So we have three things mentioned by the scholars, and these are the three bloods known to be coming out from that part of the body. The Mu'allif mentioned the first one is Damul Hayd, and this is the blood that comes out not because of illness, you get it, but just because of the natural composition of humankind, that kind of a person, the daughters of Adam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. The second one is the nifas, and the nifas is a blood that comes out because of the delivery. The child comes out, you come afterward, the blood. And the last one is istihada. This is the blood that is continuous, which doesn't stop at all, or it stops sometimes and sometimes comes back throughout the month without having a proper break. So this is istihada. He will talk here about the hayd and the nifas. As for the istihada, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam classified them into three categories. The al-mar'a al-mustahada, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned in three hadiths how to govern the issue of istihada. Hadith number one is the hadith of al-mu'tada. Hadith number two is the hadith of a person that doesn't know the ada. Mu'tada means somebody who has a custom. When you look at the hayd, you divide sisters into two categories. Somebody who has a proper system that she goes up, that's the vast majority of the people. And somebody who just begin, you get it? They don't know what is it going to be the system in the future. So the first one is somebody who has a system, they call it mu'tada. Al-mu'tada, this is the one who has ada. From the word ada, she has her own ada, they call it al-mu'tada. So she has a proper system. This one, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam talk about her. What did he say? He said she should stay and wait when she has, we're talking about mustahada, right? A person who has a continuous, blood, which doesn't stop at all. So she could be somebody who knows the ada, and she could be somebody who doesn't have an ada at all, or she used to have an ada, but she forgot the ada. And also she could be somebody who lacks both. She doesn't have an ada at all, and she cannot recognize and differentiate between the colors of the blood. I will repeat again because it's really necessary. Three people, I said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. I mean, three categories, three types of mustahada mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number one is the one that has an ada and she recognized the ada. Number two is the one that doesn't have an ada or she forgot the ada, but she can differentiate between the color of the bloods. Back again. Number one is the one that has an ada and she remembers the ada. Number two is the one that doesn't have an ada or she forgot the ada, but she can differentiate between the color of the bloods. This number two. Number three is the one who lacks both. She doesn't have an ada or she forgot the ada, and also at the same time she cannot differentiate between the color of the bloods. She doesn't know how does height looks like. What does height look like? So she doesn't have this. So these are the three types of mustahada mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The first one is the one who has an ada. What must she do? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said she should litajlis ayyama adatiha. Let her sit down in the days of her ada. When he said litajlis ayyama adatiha, she should sit down and stop praying, stop fasting, stop doing anything that is prohibited because of the hayd. Ayyam adatiha, the days of her ada. The days of her ada. What does that mean? A person usually has the ada of hayd at the beginning of the month. Let us take Muharram. Muharram. Every month, according to the Islamic calendar, the hayd comes in the first part of the month. First part of the month, 3 days in the beginning of the month. Muharram, Safar, and all of the remainder of the month in the Islamic calendar, the hayd comes the first part of the month and 3 days, the first 3 days in the month. She knows that for, let's say, 10 years, it never changed. That's the ada. So this is what we call mu'tada. She already have a fixed ada that usually it comes in the beginning of the month, it will come. It might delay 1 day, 2 days, but it comes at the beginning of the month. She knows the ada. And then after 10 years, for example, then the problem of istihada comes. Do you get it? So how can she deal with the hayd? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said the case of this woman is simple. Since she already knows the days in which hayd comes, whenever these days arrive in every month, all that she has to do is to stop praying, stop fasting, just assume that now she is in a state of hayd until the end of these days, and then she comes back to normal life. I guess it's clear, inshallah. So this is the mu'tada. Somebody who has the ada, what must she do? She stays away from fasting and praying and anything that is necessary to be rejected I mean, you stay away from it during the time of Hayd, you stay away from it in those days of Adar. So if she has 5 days in every month, at the beginning of the month, that means every beginning of the month, she has to stay away from praying for 5 days. The 5 days that usually the thing comes, she just stay away from fasting and doing anything that Hayd prohibited. I think this one is clear, inshallah. So this is what? Al-Mu'tada. That's the first one. The second one the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam discussed is the one that forgets the adah. That's al-mubtadi'ah. She has the adah, but unfortunately she forget, or she doesn't have the adah at all. That's, this is the first time the hayd comes, or istihadah came actually before the arrival of the hayd. She doesn't even know what hayd means yet. You get it? Or the hayd just came and then it came with istihadah, it moves continuously. So what must she do? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if she has a tamiz, this is the second category, right? She has tamiz. Tamiz means she can differentiate between this and that. Blood is not of the same type. Sometimes it comes having this color, sometimes it comes having the other color. So what she must do is to go back to the nature of the blood. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this type of mustahada, the one that doesn't have an adah but she can differentiate between the color of the blood, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فَإِنَّ دَمَ الْحَيْضِ أَسْوَدٌ يُعْرَفُ. He said the blood of Hayd is a black blood which is known to the sisters. So when the Hayd comes, she should observe the blood. Whenever she sees the one that is having the color of Hayd according to what she knows, what must she do? Then she should stay away from praying, from fasting, from doing anything that is supposed to be prohibited because of the existence of the Hayd until the end of the color of that blood. I guess this one also is easy. So staying away from fasting, staying away from praying, staying away from anything that is wrong during the period of Hayd until what? Until the end of that color of the blood, then she begins with a normal life. I guess it's simple. And the last one is somebody who lacks both. She doesn't have adah, and she cannot differentiate also between the color of the blood. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in another hadith, he told this woman that she should be tajlis sabat ayyamin aw sittat ayyamin fi ilmi Allah min kulli shahr. She should stay away from fasting and praying 6 to 7 days based on the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She should just assume every month that she should deduct 6 days in the month. She will not fast, she will not pray, or 7 days. This 6 or 7 days, is it based on her choice? I mean, she choose every this month 6 days, this the other month 7 days? No. They said she should look at the nature of the vast majority of the people she's living with, especially the family members, because she might be not a person who is different from the rest. So she should look in the family. Usually these people, they have hayd until what day. Then she takes what they usually get. So either 6 or 7 days, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned for her. So in the case of this woman, she's going to fast and pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a month for how many days? Either 24 days or 23 days in a month. So these are the three types of mustahada mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this knowledge is very, very, very important, because you will be having this case as long as humankind exists. So please, it's very simple the way the Prophet also mentioned it. It's based on a principle. So when a person comes to you, the first question is, do you know the adah you're having? Yes, I already know my adah. Then you return her back to the adah. The case is closed. So every month she should just look at the adah and wait, and don't pray and don't fast and don't do anything that necessitates tahara and requires tahara, and which a person cannot do it in a state of hayd. She shouldn't do it until what? Until the end of those days that she already knows. This is the first one. If she lost the days, this is the second type, but she can differentiate between black and the other color and red, she should stop fasting, stop doing anything that needs tahara from hayd. She should stop it in the days of the color of hayd, which is the black blood or any other type of blood, because it has other colors also. What it meant by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that's why he said yu'araf. Yu'araf means the sisters already know. So sister, she is the scholar and the mufti of herself. she knows what hayd means. So when she sees the blood that she believes that this is hayd, she just stops fasting, even if the blood is not black. Not necessarily that it must be black, no, even if it's not black. She knows the smell, the way it smells, and it comes very red, just like the normal blood, but it smells like hayd. We take it what? Hayd. Until the time the one that carries that smell, and then she goes back to the normal life. That's mustahada. But in terms of prayer, she prays in the days of hayd, she will not. But in the time of in the times which she is just a mustahada, she prays like anybody else, she fasts like anybody else, and she approaches the spouse like anybody else. But the only thing she has to do is to make wudu for every prayer. She cannot pray two prayers with one wudu. And this is also a general principle given to us by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which the scholars took the ruling and the law concerning somebody who is suffering from salas al-bawl. You know, salas al-bawl is what? Is a continuous passage of urine, or sometimes the motion, the poop, akramakum Allah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, or sometimes the wind, a person cannot stop it at all, it just comes by itself. Or the people who are suffering from certain illness that they have to use the bag or something in them. So how to deal with their life is to make wudu every prayer. So if she makes wudu now to pray, and then the thing comes out, in the normal circumstance, the wudu is gone. But in her case, after she makes the wudu to pray that prayer, and she cannot make wudu until the entrance of the time. She has to wait for the time first. Let's say Asr is 4. She cannot make wudu 3:59. She has to wait first until 4. When they make the adhan for Asr, then she makes wudu to pray. And if she makes the wudu, even if the blood is pouring, she doesn't pay attention to it, and you just go and pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's it. So this is also the law given to somebody who is suffering from this continuous passage of urine or something else. They make wudu for every prayer. They cannot pray two wajib prayers with one wudu. They can pray Dhuhr and all of the sunan. They can pray Dhuhr and also read Quran, no problem. But to pray Dhuhr and keep the wudu until Asr, this one doesn't work yet. They just have to make wudu for every prayer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for them. Otherwise, okay, she makes wudu and the blood comes, the wudu is gone. Go make wudu and the blood comes, the wudu is gone. When is she going to pray? Never pray in life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it simple. Just make one wudu after the entrance of the time, and then don't pay attention to what comes. This istihada is ibtila min Allah azza wa jal. It might be because of illness, and it might be because of shaitan. And that's why I really advise us to strap ourselves every day with the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from shaitan. When he talks about this istihada, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam described it as the rakda min shaitan. Shaitan is going, sometimes comes out of hatred to one of the sisters, will go and hit one of the veins, so the vein will keep on pouring the blood. How do we cure ourselves from this? The ruqya shar'iyya, recitation of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and dhikr, and also drinking those divinely given medicines such as the original honey, original black seed, and the lot tree, the siddur. Also, if you can get it, there is a honey that is taken from the siddur. If you can get it and recite Quran in it and drink it, be in light Allah, if there is something wrong in that of that nature, it will go. The other type of istihada which comes naturally, out of the normal illness, this one, normal medicine can work. Also, honey can work, black seed can work here, and also you can use the modern medicine, also it can work. I mean, there is a solution. A person should not submit just like that. Unless if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wish that this person will be tested throughout the life, then we can't do nothing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So this is concerning the istihada. Is that clear, the three rulings? Insha'Allah. Okay. Yes. Six or 7 days. She should see what is the vast majority of the community. Usually sisters in the community, because hayd usually doesn't exceed 6-7 days. Usually, normally. There are some cases where it goes beyond 15 days or so, more than that. But usually it doesn't exceed 6 or 7 days. So he said she should take either 6 or 7 days, but she should look at the vast majority of the community. If the vast of them goes for 7 is more, then she goes, she just put herself among the 7 people. to be on the safe side. If the vast majority is 6, then she goes for 6 days only. Inshallah. Yes. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what they should do is, if the thing is there, of course, they should clean it and remove it and then make wudu to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in something that is clean. But the only thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala excuse them from it is after they make the wudu and the thing comes out. If the thing is there, if they know that the blood is there, it's better to remove it and put something new and then pray in it. Before the salah, I'm talking. Yeah, before the salah. Because what is commanded by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to take something and put in the place. They don't have what we have it nowadays. They use some kumash or something that can be placed in that place and stop it. But sometimes it doesn't stop. The blood keeps on coming out. And Zainab bint Jahsh, this is the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You have Zainab bint Jahsh, Hamna bint Jahsh, Fatima bint Jahsh. They mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to test the Banat Jahsh. One of the scholars said, Banat Jahsh kulluhun mustahadat. All of the sister daughters of Jahsh, they are having the istihada. One of them is the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Zainab. A very strong and a person in terms of taqwa and also in terms of lineage and connection to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She is almost better than anybody else. But then she has this. And you know what they mention about her? She prays sometimes in the masjid. She has to bring a container or a plate to put underneath because the blood keeps on coming. She puts something, but it doesn't stop. But she prays like that. So this shows that it is okay for them to pray like this. But it is better always before they begin. If they know that the thing is there, to remove it and throw it away. And then if something new comes, then they shouldn't pay attention to it. So what I would say is, if a person is like that, well, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect, what she should do, she should make the time she change, the thing is the time she prays. But also this might be very costly. So I will just restrict it in the time that she knows that the thing is there, or it is too much. You get it? To remove it and pray comfortably is better. But if she cannot afford removing, then she just pray in the way she is. Do you get an idea? Since when the blood comes, she can just continue and pray. If she cannot afford removing it, then she prays in the way she is. You get something, inshallah. You get it, inshallah. Okay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect. Okay, I just want to finish this and then we stop. قَالَ وَأَقَلُّ الْحَيْدِ يَوْمٌ وَلَيْلَىٰ. So these are the things that we already done. He said that the minimum, the least in terms of haid is yawmun wa layla. So when the blood comes and it doesn't stay for one day and one night, it is not haid according to the madh'hab. But we mentioned last time that this is incorrect. Even one drop of blood which is haid is haid, even if it doesn't stay for a day. Wa ghalibuhu sittun aw sab'un. The vast majority of the haid is the haid stays for 6 or 7 days, and this one is okay. This is true. The ghalib, the vast majority of it, is 6 or 7 days. Wa aktharuhu 15 yawman, and the maximum is 15 days. What is the basis for this? There is no basis for this. Last time I told you there is no evidence from the Sunnah or from the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that can support this idea that haid cannot exceed 15 days. That's why some scholars mention less than that. That's why some scholars mention more than that. And that's why the best opinion is the one that says, which is taken by Imam Ad-Darimi, one of the scholars of Hadith. He says, Al-Aslu anna kulla ma yakhruju min rahim al-mar'ati annahu hayy. Anything that, any blood that comes out of the womb of a female, this is hayd, hatta tabayyana bidalil annahu istihada, until we have another evidence that shows us that this is not hayd and it is istihada. So it can go more than 15 days, as a fact. Otherwise, how is it possible? It is quite illogical. If there is a hadith from the Prophet ﷺ, we understand. But if there is no hadith from the Prophet ﷺ and there is no Quran to support this, how is it possible for a sister to have 16 days of haid? and every month it comes only 16 days. And she stopped praying for 15 days, and then day number 16 she said, this one is not hayd. And it has the same color, the same smell, the same thing. How is that logical? If there is a hadith, there is evidence we understand. But if there is nothing, how is that possible? That's why the best opinion, wallahu alam, among all of the opinions of the scholars, is the one that says it is not, it can exceed 15 days. It is not restricted to 15 days. Ibn Hazm in his book, Muhalla, he said only 17 days because this is the maximum they could find it. But somebody will come and tell you, no, we find something else also. You get it? That's why Ibn Uthaymeen said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based it on the wujud and the happening. What happens, we take it. You get it? So as long as it stays, it has a stop, it has a break, we still call it hayd. Even if the thing goes to 20 days. They mentioned that unless if the thing is taking the vast majority of the month, 28, 27, 26 days, this one is not naturally, we never heard of a situation and a case like that. So this is the only time the scholars mentioned that this is istihala. But it goes beyond 15 days, 16 days, 17 days, 20 days, it's all hayd. Unless if she already saw the tuhur and then the hayd, the blood comes back, then we will take it as something else. This one we already studied. If you go back to the previous lectures, you will get it. وَأَقَلُّ النِّفَاسِ And the minimum that we can take for nifas, the minimum is lahza, just one drop. If it comes just for 1 minute or few seconds, as long as blood comes out, we call it nifas. وَأَكْفَرُهُ سِتُّنِ يَوْمًا And the vast majority of it is 60 days. This one also, the best opinion is the one that says it can go more than 60 days. The majority of it is only 40 days. But there is no evidence to say that they cannot go more than 40 days. That's why Ibn Taymiyyah said there is nothing from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to restrict it to 40 days. But he mentioned the vast majority of the sisters is 40 days. And they say we usually wait until 40 days. It goes away from 40 days maximum. So, but it can go more than 40 days, up to 60 days or even more than that. As long as there is a time where it stopped, then we take it as istihada. You get it? Imam Al-Shafi or Imam Malik, one of them said, I know a sister who has the istihada 60 days. Every time she gave a birth of a child, she stays for 60 days and then it stopped it. So there is no evidence to restrict it to 40 days as it is mentioned by the Hanabila or some other schools. It can go beyond that also. وَأَكْثَرْهُ سِتُّنَ يَوْمًا وَغَالِبُهُ أَرْبَعُونَ And the vast majority of it stopped at 40 days. وَأَقَلُّ الطُّهُرِ بَيْنَ الْحَيْضَتَيْنِ And the minimum amount of the days that a sister spent between the two hayd, the first hayd and the next hayd to come, is 15 يَوْمًا The minimum is 15 days. 15 days. وَلَا حَدَّ لِأَكْثَرِهِ So that's the minimum. But there is no end for the maximum. Maximum it can take. A sister can stay, I think it's possible, right? Sister can stay for years. For ages without seeing hayd, and then afterward it will come. So if you say it has to be after every 15 days the next hayd has to come, then she doesn't see anything, what is she going to do? You tell her to stop praying. No, we don't do that. That's why they said it is 15 days. But even the aqal 15 days also, it is not proven. That this is the minimum also, it is not proven. Whenever she sees the blood, this is what? Hayd. Whenever the blood goes away from her, even after, the days which are less than 15 days, we call it, we call her a clean person. The blood stops. The blood comes, she is hayd, and the blood stops, and another hayd comes, even in a time which is in a period which is less than 15 days, we call the second one also hayd. So take this formula from Imam Ad-Darimi. It says any blood that comes out from a woman is hayd unless if there is an evidence which shows that this blood is istihada, then we take it for istihada. وَلَا حَدَّ لِأَكْثَرِهِ وَأَقَلُّ زَمَانٍ تَحِيدُ فِيهِ الْجَارِيَةُ أَوْ الْمَرْأَةُ And the minimum, the least in terms of age that a woman can see the damul hayd is 9 years. she has to be of 9 years old, then she can start seeing the blood. That's this opinion. Do you get it? The one that we supported last time is the one that says there is no age for this at any moment, because the Prophet ﷺ did not say that, and nobody amongst the companions of the Prophet ﷺ ever restricted after this nature to say only 9 years. No, it doesn't work. At any age she sees the blood, even before that, then we call it hayd also. Tis'usinin wa aqallu muddat al-hamli sittatu ashhur. So this one is tis'usinin. They said wa aktharuhu sittuna sana. The maximum of the age that she will not see hayd usually is 60 years. Some of them said 50 years. After 50 years she would not see. But this also is not practical, because there are cases whereby even after 60 years she sees the hayd. That's why I told you that this formula is very excellent and you should memorize it. Any blood that comes is hayd, unless if I have evidence to show to me that this is not hayd, but it is something else, then I go for that evidence. So it can come before 9 years, and it can also come even after 9 years. After 60 or after 50 or 60 years. وَأَقَلُّ مُدَّةِ الْحَمْلِ سِتَّةَ عَشْرٌ. The minimum that a sister can stay carrying a pregnancy, a child in the womb, is 6 months. That's true. Quran supports this. And a child can be born after when? After 6 months. It is to be rejected by the scientists. But then they believe in it nowadays because they found the fact. They did their own experiment and they found it to be correct. We accept it because Islam said it. In that case that happened during the time of Umar or Uthman, Ali ibn Abi Talib, one of the scholars among the companions, told the Khalifa, this woman that is supposed to be stoned to death, she's going to fight you in the hereafter. He said, why? He said, because the case against her is she delivered a child 6 months after the marriage. So according to the culture, at least she stays for how many months? 9 months. So she doesn't have this. 6 months the child comes. So they raise a case to her. So since she already married, the punishment should be what? Death penalty. So they were supposed to kill her. So then this companion said, she's going to fight you in the eyes of Allah SWT and the hereafter. In the hereafter she's going to fight you. He said, why? Abdullah ibn Abbas said, because Quran mentioned that it is possible for a child to come after 6 months. He said, how do you know that? He said, because Allah SWT says, وَحَمْلُهُ وَفِصَالُهُ ثَلَثُونَ شَهْرًا. And if you combine the period of weaning, the period of the breastfeeding of a child, you take that period and you combine, you take also the period of pregnancy, you will come up with 30 months, Allah SWT says. In Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah SWT says, He says what? وَالْوَالِدَاتُ يُرْضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ. The mothers, they should breastfeed their children for 2 years. So Allah SWT said the period of breastfeeding is how many years? 2 years. And then in Surah Al-Ahqaf, Allah SWT said, if you combine the period of the breastfeeding together with the period of the pregnancy, you will come up with how many months? 30 months, Allah SWT says it. So if I deduct 2 years from 30 months, how many months left? Six months. That's the knowledge of a companion. 1,400 years ago, this one exists in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why one of the scholars mentioned that Keith Moore, this is the father of embryology, this kind of knowledge of the fetus in the womb, he used to give lectures about the science of the fetus in the womb in the Quran, and he wasn't a Muslim in those days. They managed to convince him and he studied. He found the things that they claim to be discovering them now, but they exist in the Quran 1,000 years ago. That's the book of Allah SWT. لَا تَنْقَضِ عَجَائِبُ. And that is something amazing about Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala in this issue. Ibn Qayyim mentioned in his book, I guess this Tuhfat al-Wadud bi Ahkam al-Mawlud, he mentioned that a child usually when it comes 9 months, he will live. 7 months lives also. 6 months also lives. Before 6 months cannot. But 6 months also he will survive. But when it comes to the child coming after 8 months, they die usually. I think this is also known to the sisters. There are some who survive also a lot, but sometimes they die. So he was talking about the reason why this happened. Wallahu a'lam. He said because the process of turning upside down, this is the preparation for a child to come out, to be ready to come out. It takes, a lot of days. It will happen for about 2-3 weeks. It will take him 2-3 weeks, the baby to turn upside down. So after the process is done, so then that usually the baby, if it is not among those, I'm trying to quote him properly, if the baby is not among those babies that are given a healthy body and very strong body by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the womb, they will become like sick in the womb. So if the child is to come out at that moment, right after finishing that work, that heavy job, which is to turn upside down, right after finishing, if he's to come out, Ibn Qayyim mentioned, then he will be faced with a new environment that he's not used to it. You get it? People are shouting, he never saw somebody that's the first time, and then the air coming to him and all of these things. So you combine this with the illness that he came out with and the new environment, so they collided with each other, and then the child most likely cannot afford this. He will just go back and die. Wallahu a'lam what is going on, but this is the explanation of Ibn Qayyim to show to you the qudra of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He is the one who is controlling the system. And these type of things also to increase your iman, that we should depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to the child delivery. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows it. Wallahi, how many times the medical doctors tell you something, but then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make his own decision. Especially nowadays, it's all about business, right? The sisters in those days, 50 years ago, they don't have these hospitals, and 100 years ago, no hospitals, no anything. How did they deliver? They wait for the child until it comes. And what happened in those days? Nothing. But now they will tell you that no, it has to come out, otherwise this and this. Why didn't it happen long ago? It happens nowadays. And how many times they tell a sister that you have to come for surgery, and she goes for the surgery, and I'm telling you, if she is to wait, the child will come. Even recently, we have a case like that. So they told one of the brothers that you have to wait for 2 weeks. It is impossible for the child to come out now because they see the child is still ready there. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring it out in 30 minutes. They're talking about 2-3 weeks, so that you should know that the one who is controlling the system is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't you ever depend on what the medical doctor is telling you all the time. Use your own intellect. Sometimes business also works. I just want you to come back for the business sake. So this is what the Shaykh is talking about. The pregnancy can stay for 6 months. After 6 months, it can come out. That's the minimum. And then it can stay also in the womb of a mother. He said, وَأَكْثَرُهُ أَرْبَعُ سِنِينَ. And the maximum is 4 years. How is that? The maximum is 4 years. This is where the kufr lies in our own many contemporary people. They don't agree with this. And you see, this is almost the consensus of all of the past and the previous scholars. There are some few who doesn't agree with this. They just say 9 months, 9 months. Only 9 months. It cannot go beyond 9 months. And this one is wrong. But the vast majority of the scholars, they believe that pregnancy can stay up to 4 years. They mentioned certain scholars, even Imam Malik, they said the mother was with him for 4 years. That's why they have also a fact that some of them, when they come out, they have teeth. So you say to him, As-salamu alaykum, maybe he can reply, Fakabar bak. And then the mother will run away. But this is also a fact with them. The Shafi madhab says 4 years. And you have some scholars, some madhab up to 5 years. The Malikis is up to 7 years. Do you get the idea? Up to 7 years. It can stay. So what happened nowadays? The doctor says, no, this is impossible. The child will grow and explode. They don't remember that the one who is controlling the situation is who? Allah. True or false? We are growing, right? Slowly, right? When we are born, we are like this. And now you are big, right? At 21 years, usually you stop growing, right? Right or wrong? 21 or certain age, you will never grow again. Who stopped the growing? That's Allah. We all agree with this. He grows you up to that age and then he stopped it. Ibn Uthaymeen said, what is happening is Allah SWT has stopped the process of growing of a child in the womb. He will just remain like that. He is there, but it will never grow again. Does he have the power to do that? Yes. This is very simple with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we do believe that a pregnancy can go beyond 9 months. And we accept that. But when it comes to 4 years, they said, no, this is unacceptable. Why do you accept more than 9 months? I have a friend of mine. He told me that his wife never delivered before 1 year. She will conceive now and the child will stay for 12 months and then it will come out. How do you explain that then? And nowadays some people, they will tell you if it stays for a few weeks, then it will explode. But that one, it stays for 1 year every time. So I'm just telling you this because this is what they believe in it. And I also believe in it, that it is possible. And they have also nowadays the scientists, some of the scientists, they call it a sleeping embryo. That's what I found in writing. One of the cases I was reading, they have this sleeping embryo. This sleeping embryo is a child that was there, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stopped it from growing at all. There was a case during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, narrated in Muwatta Imam Malik, or during the time of Umar ibn Khattab. In this case, the woman was, she married and then she delivered a child before the time. So there was a case on her. And one old woman, she comes and explains what really happened. Because she has a marriage previously, and there was a relationship between her and the previous husband. So she conceived from that time, but the pregnancy is there, not moving, not growing at all. And nobody knows because it is not that big. When she married the second one and she had a relationship with him, that relationship wake up the old pregnancy which belongs to the former, the previous husband. Then the child comes back again. Nowadays, even the science also confirms this. But still you have some contemporary people rejecting this fact mentioned by the scholar, which is almost based on consensus among them. They do believe in it, that it happens in that way. So I just want you to understand what they mean and look at your time and deal with it accordingly. We have a way to bring out the child if it is complete. They don't have a way, they have a way. They have to wait for the child to come out at any time it wants it. Do you get the idea? Nowadays when it comes, we will go for the inducement and then she will deliver a child. In those days, what do they have? They don't have anything. They just wait for the child for the period that last one to want to bring it out and it will come out. So the Shafi'i scholars, they mention 4 years for the pregnancy to stay. These issues usually arise when there is a case in the court when a rejection of a child comes into existence. The father doesn't accept the child to be his and the mother is saying this is yours. If she can prove it, she could be exonerated based on this fact. And we attribute the child to him and also to protect the interests of the child in the future. So we do believe it can happen according to what is mentioned by the early scholars, and we trust that. Science is not the base for us to reject what used to be a fact mentioned by the scholars for almost more than 1,000 years. So that's the vast majority and the maximum of the pregnancy that can stay with the woman for 4 years. وَغَالِبُهُ تِسْعَةَ أَشْهُرٍ, and the vast majority of the pregnancy, it only stays for nine months. So, Allahu Alam, this is the summary of what we did before we stopped the classes. And this is the last thing I will do in this lesson. I decided to exceed it because I took time also advising you. So, inshallah, I will stop here, bismillahi ta'ala. You have 7 minutes for question and answers. After that, we close the class and then I will see you next week, bismillahi ta'ala, inshallah. Please, I need somebody to volunteer to write the names of people who come. Inshallah. I just want to monitor who is with us and who is not with us. Just write in a piece of paper and then pass it to us, inshallah. So we have 6 minutes left for question and answers. Barakallah. Any question? Any question? Yes. No problem. Hmm. Yes. Yeah, she recites. You see, if there are no men, no brothers, or she's with the maharim, she reads like anybody else. She reads like anybody else. Just in the way the brothers also raise up their voice when they read, this is how she recited. And she try also to read it nicely, beautify her voice in the way anybody reads it. So the only thing, difference that we have between brothers and sisters in terms of prayer is when she prays in front of others. But if there is nobody and they are alone in their masjid, she raises up her voice if no brothers around in the place. But if there are brothers also next to the masjid, for example here, she leaves and the brothers come sometimes next to the sister session and read their books and revise, it's better to lower her voice in such a way she will hear the people next to her. She shouldn't also go very silent. She raises up a little bit in such a way the people next to her can hear the voices. Wa alaikum as-salam. In Dhuhr and Asr prayer? Silent, yeah. This we're just talking about the prayers where a person should raise up his voice. Maghrib, Isha, and Fajr, right? Dhuhr and Asr, this one, even for the brothers, is supposed to recite silently. Is it good for the sisters whenever they pray, if they're in group, to pray in Jama'ah? Yes. It's good also for them to pray in Jama'ah. Yes. What, do we have white wine and... Okay. Name in Islam, phrases and name have no place at all in terms of making a ruling. What matters is the content. That's why they mention al-ibratu fil uqud bil maqasid wal ma'an. No, al-umuru bi maqasidha. The real recognition is based on the content and the meaning. So when it comes to the intoxicant, the focus is intoxication. Whatsoever intoxicates is called in Islam khamr, wine. If this one, what is that? Marker, right. If I write with this for 20 years, did I get intoxicated? No. If let's say this marker, somebody does something with it in such a way, if I touch it, I will get intoxicated. It is haram for me to touch it. But if before it wasn't, right. The water I drink, I realized that the first person he came, it was no more water, and then somebody came and drank it in my house and then get drunk. What does that mean? It is haram for me to drink it because it reaches the level of intoxication. And there we go. Whatever they say, we just focus on the thing they put inside. If the thing intoxicates, we call it haram thing and we call it also wine. A person is not allowed to use it, whether it is in a vinegar or whatever, you can't use it at all. It's prohibited for you to use it because of what? Intoxication. Do you get the idea? If you have this principle, then you will be, okay, and everything will be clear for you. Do you get it? So the point is, calling it alcohol doesn't matter, because there are things which are chemically called alcohol, but they don't cause somebody to be intoxicated, right? They mentioned that there is the type of alcohol which is chemically used, right? It will make you blind if you drink. If you drink as big as you are, you will never become intoxicated. You will die because it is poison. You get it? You will become blind, you will die, you become ill, but still the akal is there. Yeah. This one is not haram because it is wine, but it is haram because it is harmful to your life. You can't take it without the prescription from the medical doctor, which says to you, this is medicine, you have to use it in that way. If you use it, you will get okay. Do you get the idea? So please do take this principle. Whatsoever it intoxicate is prohibited. They call it alcohol, they call it whatever they call it, wine, white, black, blue, green, whatever they name it. As long as the intoxication is there, then a person is not allowed to make use of it at all. If it is made from something that would never, let's say if somebody drinks that vinegar, he keeps on drinking, will never get intoxicated, then it's okay. Because technically there is no alcohol in it. Again, that's why concerning the perfumes, which contains also alcohol, the scholar said if the percentage of alcohol in it is just like non-existent, 0.something, if you are to keep on drinking the same perfume, the same, you keep on drinking, you will never get intoxicated, then it's okay for you to use that perfume, because technically the wine is not in existence in that perfume. But if, let's say, if you drink a larger amount of that perfume, because some people, they do that when they couldn't get the wine, they were banned by the government, they go and get those things they can afford. You get an idea. There are other things they used to take which will get them what they want. You get an idea. But if the percentage is like non-existent, the scholar said it's okay for a person to use it. Wallahu a'lam. Any last words? Okay, thank you very much. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase your iman. And please, as I always beg you, please don't skip the class. So we have only one day now, right? And it's going to be maximum 1.5 hours. Bismillah ta'ala to finish the class. If we go more than that, we go 2 hours together with the Arabic class, inshallah, starting from next week, bismillah ta'ala. See you with Allah Ta'ala next week. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Barakallahu.